getting heat. Time to take a stand, boys. Time to make a choice. Time to find our courage. Time to be deployed. Make our only stand here. Make our roads complete. All we waited for now, past and future meet. Get your weapons ready. Kiss loved ones goodbye. Now our time is coming, and it is not the time to cry. Settle wrong from right. In the time of conflict, when the bullets fly, in the space of seconds, a life you cannot buy. Face the facts before you, face the simple truth. We're hopelessly outnumbered, it's tragic but it's true. Make your last formation, take the final road. Now it's time for endings, now it's time to go.
Song. Hello, everyone. Welcome to my stream. What's going on, everyone? It is good to see everyone today. It is a very special stream, as we will talk about in just a minute. Hello to Ujiplex, Mining Miner. Hello to the kids, Snipdog, Smacky Butts, Shane Plays, Rosa Gastina. What's up, Roix? Hello, Pryles. What's up, Miley? Hello, Messiah. What is going on, Lord Sloth? Hello, Night Jim. What is up, K Money? Hello, Hagoya. Hello, HBS Robin, HBS Rebecca, HBS Mike, HBS Jeff, and HBS Check. There are a lot of HBSs in here. I wonder why. We'll find out. Glog78, a pleasure to have Glog in here. What's up, Glob? What's up, Epidemic? Hello, Dragonspear. Hello, Dark Vegetaman. What is up, Thorg? What's up, Shadowed Mage? Hello, Lego Freak. What's up, Satobo? What is up, Fallen? Hello to everybody, and we will get a lot more as well. It's wonderful to see everyone, and this is, in fact, a special stream tonight because it's connected to that little picture that you guys see on the stream. First of all, I want to welcome everyone in, and I am going to introduce these people very quickly. Before I do, I just want to mention that the game we're playing tonight, Shadowrun Returns, Dragonfall, the Director's Cut, is available on Steam. It's also available in a bunch of other places, which I will ask them about momentarily. But Steam is where I just got it from. And so if you like what you see and hear over the course of the evening, please make sure to support these guys and get this product. Because one of the reasons, I suspect, that we were able to get a Director's Cut is the fact that we were able to get enough interest in Dragonfall. And obviously, we all all want more RPGs. I think that's something we can all agree on. That's something we all want. So that is the deal with that. But it's wonderful to have everybody here. Hello to everyone. And now I'm going to, in fact, put myself on screen for a minute. Let me get rid of this. And let me put on that. Hello, everyone. It's good to see everybody. And I am going to introduce my three guests. I have actually had these folks on here before, specifically when Dragonfall, Shadowrun Returns Dragonfall actually released, which was a few months back. I don't remember actually exactly when. I'll ask them because they'll know. I was lucky enough to have these three folks on, and they were kind enough because I ran into one of them at Gen Con, and he was kind enough to schedule this with me. And as I mentioned to you guys, I think he got in a little bit of trouble because he scheduled it on the day of release, and I was like, well, it's too bad, no backsies. You got to do it now, so that's the deal. And so these guys were kind enough to join me for a second time. And the people I'm speaking about, of course, are Mitch Gittleman, the executive producer at Harebrained Schemes, Mike McCain, who is the art and lead developer of Shadowrun Returns Dragonfall, and Andrew McIntosh, who was the lead writer on Dragonfall. And gentlemen, it is wonderful to have all of you guys back. Welcome back. Thank you again.
Woo! Yeah. Thank you.
So I'm going to add this video into the stream, and I want to ask you guys a couple of opening questions. Chat, you know, feel free to say hello to these wonderful people. Thank you for the follow hug. As I'm getting your guys' video up here, I want to start by asking a little bit about what gave you the idea for a director's cut, other than the fact that it's, you know, cool and awesome and everyone likes to do it on DVDs and stuff like that. What convinced you guys that there was a market, there was an interest for expanding, as I gather? I'm going to ask you about specifically what this does differently from the original, but what gave you the idea to sort of do a director's cut in the first place? And that's for whoever wants to take it.
Yeah, well, you know, so I think it started with, we got a lot of feedback from people that were really excited about Dragonfall, and they asked us, why isn't there a standalone version of this? You know, I just want to be able to dive right into Dragonfall. So we said, yeah, let's make a standalone version. And same time, you know, we've been able to see a lot of fan feedback and everything on the game. And there's a lot of stuff that we wanted to add the first time around, didn't quite get a chance, improve. And so that just kind of led to this, well, why don't we take this great game that we already have and try to make it better?
Okay. Did it turn out to be a larger project than you anticipated? Maybe he asked, probably assuming the answer is always yes. I mean, did it turn out to be more work than you imagined, thinking of it as I can just tweak sort of the existing product? Or, I mean, were there a lot more moving parts than perhaps you had expected?
There's always a lot of moving parts.
Mitch is cracking up behind you, which tells me that it was.
Was it, well, bigger, I'm sorry, I'm not the director.
Oh,
the director,
exactly.
Was it bigger than you thought it was going to be?
Yeah, no, sure, it was definitely bigger.
We just kept adding stuff. Like, wouldn't it be cool if, hey, let's do 10 new songs. And like, yeah, great. New endings. Yeah, that'd be cool. New UI. How about AI? Yeah, let's do that too. Cats and dogs living together, seeking achievements.
I'm wondering what parts of the game we didn't touch at this point.
Ah, really? I mean, did it involve a lot of sort of heavy, I mean, was it a lot of heavy recoding also? I mean, or is it more, I'm wondering how much of it was addition and how much was subtraction, I guess, is the way I'd ask it.
Yeah, you know, I mean, there's a few cases, like the new combat interface, there are certainly some parts that we just kind of ripped out and did over again.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, no, for the most part, oh, and the AI was another area where a pretty new system to take the place of a lot of stuff that we had before, but everything else was pretty additive.
Okay.
You know, all the new missions sort of complement and extend on the character arcs that were already there, and mm-hmm. we did a lot of cool work to sort of integrate that so that it wasn't just like, hey, this character has a new mission now, but it actually tied into the rest of their experience over the course of the campaign as well.
I see.
Yeah, and for some of those characters, you know, Laurie's story, for example, was pretty clearly written with the idea that there would be a mission at the end of it, and we just didn't have the time to do that in the original release of the game. For the other characters, we already knew that there wasn't going to be that time allocated. We just couldn't do it right in the time that we had. So their stories were kind of written without that, you know, they were written with their own resolutions that wouldn't require omission,
okay.
But we're able to find good organic places to tie missions related to their backstories in to the existing structure of the game. And that actually worked out really well for us.
Okay.
Because, you know, that way you don't have a whole pile of missions right at the end of the game that are impeding the flow of the third act.
Right. So, I'm thinking a little bit actually of in Mass Effect 2, you have these loyalty missions that if you don't complete them, it has a significant effect on the way the end of the game works. I happen to like Mass Effect 2, but I have heard one of the critiques being that you got to go, you know, run around almost errand, you know, dealing with errands to sort of get everything set up before you can proceed with the story, or the story won't unfold the way that you would want it to. So it's almost like you're forging ahead towards this final conclusion. And then it's like, now stop and go to the, go shopping, you know, for 5 hours or whatever, and then come back. So you were trying to avoid that essentially. Is that
that's exactly what we didn't want. You know, the way that I look at this, all of your companions are professionals. They have their own issues, and it's great if you can help them
issues
out.
Issues in quotes.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, if they didn't have issues, they probably wouldn't be doing this for a living.
Right.
But you know, if you can't get to it, that isn't necessarily going to be, throw up a huge speed bump toward finishing the game. So, you know, the missions have various degrees of priority based on, I don't want to give any spoilers away here, but I think we were able to incorporate the missions pretty organically. I'm very happy with how it all worked out.
Okay. Let me ask you, Mike, about the songs, and I'll just ask one or two more questions, and then we'll actually get into playing a little bit. And actually, before I ask you about the songs, how much, because I know that the saves obviously don't transfer over, there's no way to integrate them, so when I start up again, how soon will we be able to start noticing some differences, you know, in the director's cut? In other words, is there, you know, like how much of the introductory sequence? I'm just trying to think back about, you know, how far you get in before you get to the hub, you know?
You know, I think pretty much as soon as you hit combat, you're going to see a lot of new stuff.
Okay, cool.
So not only is the interface in combat been completely redone, but the combat mechanics themselves are pretty different now.
Okay.
And you've also got some fun stuff like when you crit enemies, they'll explode.
Ooh, got a little Mortal Kombat edition. Nice.
There's some more blood. Nice. And things like that.
More blood is always positive. Let me also, since a couple people have asked, multiboxing one thing, just as far as the link is concerned, yeah, exactly, Lego just did it, because we have an automated link bot system, because the channel's growing, which is great, but it means that we have a few spam bots that have popped in, so as long as you have permission, you can put the link in there. One reminder to everybody as well, I'm going to ask a few questions up front, and then I promise, give you guys a chance to ask questions as well of these guys, and when I do that, if you can do exactly what multiboxing did, he did everything right, just the link got in there, to put, to basically put question, which is exactly what multiboxing just did, in capital letters, and then follow it up with your question. So hold on to that thought, and I will, you know, ask those questions shortly, to be able to give you guys a chance to talk. So, okay, Mike, the song, what I was going to ask you about was the songs. You said 10 more songs, and I know that you were responsible for the sort of some of the music side also, right? Being able to add those in, or you weren't the music lead, but I mean, you were the sort of head guy who was like supervising it. I'm wondering where the 10 songs came from, I guess, is what I'm asking about.
Sure, yeah. So I was the game director. I mean, beyond sort of, we would brainstorm here with the design team.
As I thought, yeah.
You know, for Glory's mission, this is the kind of thing we're going for. But beyond that, the music's all the work of John Everest. He's a awesome composer that we...
Same guy who did the other stuff, right? The previous...
No. So he did the trailer music
for
Shadowrun Returns and also for Dragon Ball and also for Golem, actually. And we've been working with him ever since. We love the guy.
Okay.
So he did a couple pickup tracks for Dragonfall, the original release, and then and then did a whole bunch more tracks that we really love for the director's cut.
Interesting. And you were adding, would you say most of these are more like sort of atmospheric music tracks, or were there specific sort of missions? I know you don't want to give away spoilers, but were there specific missions that the music was keyed to, or or things of that sort. And I might actually, while you're answering that, ask you about the art assets as well, which I know is more directly in your wheelhouse too, Mike. Like, what about those things? Did you request for more art assets? And again, was that more for background and atmosphere or specific, you know, mission requirements?
Several of the new tracks are for the companion missions that Andrew was talking a little bit about. And so we thought, you know, it's always fun to have music that's sort of more tailored to the backstory and the personality of these different characters. So we thought that would be a good approach to take. And then there's a few more tracks that pertain to just new content and giving us a little bit more variety in the music pool as a whole. There's one or two surprises on the soundtrack too.
Ooh, neat. That's what I like to hear. What about the art side? Did you commission a lot of extra art? What was that like?
Sure. Yeah. So we did a quite a few new portraits to support the new content, and we commissioned that through our portrait artist Dave Nash. We've done the majority of the portraits for Dragonfall with concepts from one of our in-house artists, Holly here, and then the rest of the environment art and the new character art that was all done by our amazingly talented art team here at Hair.
Excellent.
Stuff though, there's all new environments. We take you outside of Berlin.
Oh, nice.
There's a more like corporate residential area, which is a side of Shadowrun that we hadn't really touched before with the environment art. So
I see.
Yeah, just fun stuff.
So we get to go hang out with the 1%.
Exactly.
Gotcha.
Yeah. It's not quite.
It's a different, maybe, okay, a different kind. So one last thing I want to ask, and then we'll actually get into the game itself. I was very impressed when I played Dragonfall. I mean, as you know, I was a big fan of this game to begin with. I like Dead Man's Switch also. But I was really impressed in Dragonfall with the way that the mechanics and everything about the game sort of flowed together. There were a lot of these sort of lovely touches. I continue to be awestruck at the idea, at the genius idea of having admin be a password for something. I love that. You know, I did just these little sort of internal touches that are, you know, clever and smart and just, you know, makes the whole thing feel coherent. So I want to start this one with Mike, and then I want to move it over to Mitch too. As you were sort of adding these things in, I can imagine that there's the opportunity for it to get a little bit unwieldy. You know, you add so much that the thing kind of doesn't hold together as well as it did before. And you kind of get the sense that, yeah, you know, it was this great, coherent whole and Dragonfall story in and of itself. But if you add in all these other parts, you know, you run the risk, it seems to me, in some cases of having it be kind of lesser in a way than what it was before. So I'm curious about what your guiding principle, Mike, was in trying to keep that from happening and integrating it rather than just kind of, you know, making this sort of disturbing automaton of all these extra bits that you sort of put around the edges, if that makes sense.
Right. Yeah, it is a good question. I would say, first of all, the reason that it doesn't all result in a giant soup of game and missions is we've got an awesome test team, both internally and an external team, that's done a really great job with catching all the things that we might miss as far as continuity and the sort of the ripple effect of some of the new stuff that we've added. So major kudos to those guys. As far as like narratively speaking, I think not only did we sort of fatten the middle of the game, but we've added more stuff along the main narrative thrust of the story too. So there's two new alternate endings that actually can change the way things play out at the end.
Wow.
The new missions aren't just sort of like one-offs, right? There's let's see, without spoiling, they're tied into existing stuff, right? So what we tried to do is make sure that everything we were doing was natural to the experience and not just like, hey, we thought it'd be cool to do this other thing, let's shoot one of that in.
Even when Mitch came to you and said this would be cool, add this.
Oh, no. Yeah, well, you know, that's good.
No, Jordan.
That actually leads me to, let me ask you that one, Mitch, directly, because one of the things I'm also impressed with you guys, I mean, I know, I don't remember if this is on your Twitter feed or on your website, that it says a bunch of insanely talented people stuck in a small room. I don't know if it's a room the size of a... Yeah, is that what it is? Making cool stuff.
We have a couple rooms now, but we started in literally somebody else's closet.
Nice. So you're gradually broadening out. But what I want to ask about that, because, I mean, part of it, yes, is Jordan has this vision too. But also, you've got to have this vision, and you specifically as the executive producer here, you got to have a vision, it seems to me, to keep this all functioning together so that people go, Harebrained Studios are the guys who do really cool stuff because they do this, because they do a project that's kind of coherent and works together, or because they do something very innovative, but they do it in a way that makes it so it's not irritating as well as being innovative, or something like that. In other words, you have to have a kind of a... Yeah, like a company vision, I guess. And I'm curious if you could tell me sort of that from your point of view as a studio head, you know, as a guy who's you know, working with Jordan all the time. How do you do that?
Well, it's called Harebrained Schemes for a reason, right? Okay. As you said, we do whatever messed up thing.
Hold on, I got a freeze here. Hold on, internet connection problem. Bear with me. Bear with me for just a moment. Hold on, we'll get this call back. Hang on. Ah, the joys of Skype video. Hang on a second, everybody. Hang in there, folks. I'm still here. Exactly, mining. Picnic basket. Yeah, exactly. It was the NSA's fault. Yeah, apologies for the link stuff. I've disabled the link thing, by the way, so people will be able to post links if they want to as part of the question. Thank you, TR Red Skies. We'll get these guys back in just a second, so bear with me. Let me try this again. Still got a connection problem. I'm still running fine, right? You guys can all see me with no problem? I don't think I'm having an internet issue, so you guys are okay on my end?
Hey,
I think
Greg.
I got him back. Yeah, I got you back. Are
Greg?
You, can
Hello?
You hear me? Yeah.
Hello?
Yes. Uh-huh. Can you guys hear me?
Yeah, hey, we're on my cell phone right now. The internet died.
There was a power failure here.
Oh, my gosh. All right.
If the video work, we'll see what happens. Whoa, okay,
look at that.
That's me.
There we go.
How uncomfortable is that?
There you go.
No, that's not bad.
We've revealed the extra information.
How's
nice.
Can you guys all see us? Is this cool?
Yes, they can see you now. I will just make an adjustment there. Okay. Good, that works. The miracle of cell phones, thank God.
Yeah.
Yeah, sorry. I was wondering what was going on. Now I know. So.
Yeah, sorry. I was waxing poetic, mother.
Yeah, it was beautiful. You guys missed out.
You missed it.
Well, the NSA, I think, shut us down, chat said. So.
Next question, please. What was the last thing you heard, Greg?
The last thing I heard was we're called Harebrained Schemes for a reason, and then it cut out.
Yeah, mic drop. That's it. So,
we're really all you need to hear.
You know, you're not going to see a strong through line to our games, really, other than we like to make games that people have to think about.
Okay.
You know, but really, if you think of Harebrained Schemes, I think we hope people think two things. One, that it's a really passionate group who really gives a hoot. How'd I do that? Mm-hmm. Who really gives a hoot about their games and works really, really hard to make great stuff. And then the other thing is we care deeply about the audience for the games.
Mm-hmm.
And, that level of service and that relationship with the audience is critical to us. Those are the two most important things to us, I think. That's what defines Harebrained Schemes for me.
Gotcha.
And we drink good booze. Yes.
Absolutely.
Yes. I gave them explicit permission. So if anyone's out there, Shivas Regal, some sponsorship would be
that
nice.
Is,
That'd be just
hold
fine.
On. Sorry, no offense.
Ironic since I don't drink, but all my guests can
One
you know,
finish
drink
15 over here.
Okay. Sounds good.
20th anniversary.
There you go. All right. Well, let me actually get into the game here, and we can comment a little bit as we're doing it. Andrew, let me throw a question over to you. Yeah. As you're writing the new storylines and things like that, were there things? I mean, I know you mentioned this sort of generally, but I'm thinking of specifically for you. Were there things that you were like, God, I really hope we get a director's cut so I can write this. You know what I mean? Like, yes, I have to cut it, but oh man, I really want to do. Did you get to? Did that exist? And is that? Has that need been satiated for you in this?
Yeah, absolutely, and certainly yes. I mean, from the very beginning, actually, from my initial interview with the company to get brought on for the first Dragonfall, I wanted to do companion missions. Glory was my audition piece.
Right, I remember that. Yep.
And she was written with the so she was written with the intent of her story culminating in a mission in mind. And so that was something that I'd always wanted to do, and it was something that we all wanted to do, but there just wasn't going to be time for it. And beyond that, some of the other stories that have been added, the other missions that have been added, are all based on setup that we put into the game that we just didn't have time to pay off in the way that we wanted to.
Mm-hmm.
And so with the director's cut, we've been able to include that payoff and that extra that extra context for individuals that were already in the game.
Right.
And
that's why it doesn't feel bloated.
Exactly,
right?
Exactly.
Or just off track.
Right, right. I mean, you know, what we're doing is providing a little more elaboration and context on things that were already there, as opposed to trying to shoehorn things in that didn't belong there in the first place.
I see. And were you, I mean, how many people did you have, by the way, working? Was it, you was more than just you on the writing, besides, of course, you guys are always talking, but, were there a few writers on this, like any new writers that you had to sort of shepherd in there, Andrew, or Mike?
On the director's cut, it was me.
Okay.
All of the new stuff is basically me. Mike provided a little bit of writing assistance with one of the conversations. But beyond that, the director's cut content was all me.
Okay.
I was often working with, sort of placeholder dialogue that designers would put in on their levels. So they would assist me in that way.
Mm-hmm.
But the general storylines and finished execution was all my work.
I see. Okay. So I guess that took care of the coherency issue.
Yeah.
There's no problem with that. I guess I don't know whether I should ask this when you guys are still, high on the excitement of having released such a successful product, but is there more stuff that you wish you had time to do that will get the definitive Game of the Year Director's Cut Edition bundle pack? You know, I mean,
there's always more stuff that we wish we could do.
There's always more that could happen. Okay.
I don't think that will ever change. But we're very happy with the amount of stuff that we were able to both improve upon and add to the title.
Yeah.
We're not holding anything back, for the Game of the Year edition or anything like that.
Right, right.
Well, you know, they all say that. They all say that this is they're not holding anything back.
We think that the limit, we can probably only append 3 or 4 additional titles at the end of the game. After that, it just becomes superfluous.
Mm-hmm.
But you could use a smaller font.
It's true.
Right. And then, yeah.
Hey, Mr. Graphic Designer.
Apparently me.
I think that making a game is like painting a picture. It's only done when you say it is. You could noodle on it forever if you wanted to.
Yeah, or when I say it is. Budget says you're done.
There's that.
Yeah, right. And also like painting a picture, you've got to call it sometime. I mean, there's got to be a point where it's done and you move on to the next thing.
And Mitch, was there a time when, and by the way, in case people are wondering what I'm doing, I am popping up, just getting the thing running. When I was downloading it, I had a couple internet issues initially, so it's running, obviously, as you can hear, I'm just getting it up there. So when you guys were, I mean, how many times did you have to say, I guess, Mitch, you know what, budget says you're done? I mean, how many times did you have to say, guys, come on, are you kidding me? Like, we can't, I mean, I know you said you brought a bunch of stuff to Mike to deal with, so maybe it was going the other direction, but I'm
wondering. No, that's just not the way it worked. Mike and I, at the beginning of the project, scoped, here's what we're going to do. Mike said, I want to do this, I want to do this, I want to do this. It's like, yes to all. It was pretty easy.
Oh, okay.
I like saying yes. I hate saying no.
Sure.
We came up with what we call a bottoms-up budget. Here's mm-hmm. how much
each of these things will cost, it'll add up to this much. Then we added in some discretionary budget that Mike can play around with any way he wants, and as long as he stays within that budget, he can do anything he wants.
Okay. Wow. Mike, did you ever find yourself...
statement about we drink good alcohol.
Did you ever find...
The other thing that really helped is we got a full-time producer that joined us for the start of this project. So, you know, we actually... I think we made our original date.
We made the original date. We stayed within budget. Shout out to Weasley. Appreciate that.
That's amazing, by the way, to be able to do both those things. And actually, we have that person in chat, don't we? Don't we have the
producer? Yeah, that's Rebecca. Yeah,
she is.
Wow. So hi, Rebecca. So congratulations. Well done.
Hi, Rebecca.
I guess I should ask Rebecca whether she ever had to tell them no, or you know, whether she was like, no, that's not that's not the way that it worked.
We are a yes company.
You're a yes company.
See Golem Arcanum for more details. We say yes. Well, that's a ridiculously large project that's going to be really hard. Yeah, okay, let's do that.
That's really funny.
Not if you're our wives.
Right, that's right. Less funny in that situation. Well, and I guess that's a good point, too. I guess that a project like Shadowrun, which is a little bit... I mean, it's kind of a... You know, D&D is a very sort of stable brand. You know what you're getting with it. And Shadowrun Returns has always been about kind of being, I don't know, exuberant and sort of, what is this about? And like, how is all this work together? And you've got orcs in a steampunk, in a cyberpunk world? What is that? You know, so I wonder if Shadowrun only could be made correctly, as an RPG anyway, by a group like you guys who are kind of like, whatever, you know, let's give it a shot. I mean, I don't know if you guys embraced that view of how to make it, but it certainly seems like that's part of why it was successful, is that you're able to work with stuff that seems crazy, you know?
Either that, or we just don't know any better.
Or you don't know any better. Well,
it's
think...
It's definitely a blend of that. Yeah. No, there's an absolute level of stupidity here that we embrace. I embrace it. And then I embrace it. Like, screw it, let's go. And there have been times, although Mike doesn't really like me saying this, where many, many times where we paint ourselves into a corner and then we fight our way out.
Interesting.
And that's just
that happens. Yes.
That happens.
And that's
like, wow, how are we going to pull that up? I don't know.
Yep. Yep.
But we will.
Yep. It's sort of that I've talked to writers about this. Tim Powers, I don't know if you know him, but pretty well-known fantasy writer who did the Pirates of the Caribbean and is a really gifted speculative fiction writer, has said that he often paints himself into a corner somewhat on purpose as a writer to kind of see how he gets out of it. And that's, he says, if you ever feel like, oh, no, this project is completely fine and nothing could go wrong with it, that's when you're in trouble. You know, you always
oh, we've never felt that way.
Okay.
No, that's
not part of our DNA.
I don't think so.
No. No, screw it. We tend to just sort of go for it headlong, and then I'm gonna get a tattoo with this: improvise, adapt, overcome.
Ah, very nice. Improvise, yeah. Adapt, overcome.
Our CTO Chris has a tattoo on his arm that has easy, medium, hard, and hard mode selected.
Oh, nice. It's the opposite of the staples button.
I mean, one thing I'd like to add is, I mean, so the Shadowrun universe is crazy, and there's all kinds of stuff going on. So sort of my approach to writing with that in that universe is, while the rules of the world are crazy, it does still have rules.
Oh, yeah.
And so it's about respecting the framework of what can happen in this world and working within that. And, as with anything, those limitations actually increase the amount of creativity that you can put into the project, because you have things that you can bounce off of and play off of while remaining respectful to the source material.
Interesting. And it really gives you, it's nice that you've got sort of a rich background material with the guy who did it, by the way, I mean, with Jordan right there to be able to constantly consult. Speaking of which, how does he feel about the director's cut and how you guys handle things with this?
Jordan, weeps about the director's cut. He's very, very proud of the team because, you know, Mike and the team really did this without Jordan. We were working very, very hard on Golem Arcana at the time.
Mm-hmm.
And so, you know, he was a regular consultant, but not hands-on the way he was with Shadowrun Returns. And so there's a real paternal love for Dragonfall specifically from him, because one of the things, his whole career is about setting up these worlds and these games where other people can take them and run with them and add value to them. And when he sees it working the way it is, he gets, there's a Yiddish word for it, beklempt. It means sort of choked up.
Interesting. So he,
so he's
so,
very, very proud of the team.
So he was totally down with it, basically. All said and done.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
We've shipped two games in as many months, too, which is it's pretty cool.
Yeah.
and rather unheard of for a studio your guys' size. Later on, I will try to get... I actually heard Mitch try to field this question. I mean, not try to. He did field this question at Gen Con, and he managed to dodge it tactfully and with grace. So I'll see if I can get him to answer the question about will see if I can get him to answer what is up next for you guys, and I'll see if I can you know, nail him down on that.
I'm gonna have some Glenfiddich while you do what you're doing.
So all right, let's go with that. Now, as far as the is there anything different in the character creation part of things, or not so much?
I think character creation's pretty much the same. You might notice a few new skills on the karma track.
And new portraits.
New portraits and new hairstyles as well.
Okay. Yeah, that's right.
Flock of seagulls.
Absolutely.
Did you have a lot of people asking, you know what I really need is more hairstyle? Did you have a specific hairstyle? Someone was like, please give us a mullet right now? Or, you know, like, where is my, I don't know, where are my dreadlocks?
I said there had to be a Flock of Seagulls hairdo as a joke, but one of the artists took me seriously, and it's in the game.
Really?
True story.
That's funny. Okay, let's see. Well, when I played through this, I played a shaman because I love the idea of summoning things, which was neat. Let's see. Okay, we got that confirmed. I used bear, cat. Maybe I'll change that around. Let's see. How about 15% to hit? That sounds positive. I did have this experience while playing through. We did not get a chance to talk about it last time, about having done a tremendous job of never choosing the etiquette I ever needed at the right time. So it's always like, I chose one, I'm like, this is great, and it's like, security. I'm like, right, that's clearly the one etiquette I don't have, so of course you're going to ask me for that. That's lovely. So that happened all the time. It has nothing at all to do with you guys. It was just me being like, really? I can't even... I don't... etiquettes.
You have a recommendation for him, Andrew? For etiquette?
As far as etiquettes are concerned? Well, I've really tried to... we've tried to put an emphasis on making some of the lesser-used etiquettes come up a little more often.
Ah.
That said, it is hard to go wrong with security, gang, corporate... even academic is used a fair amount. It really comes down to what kind of character you want to play.
All right. Well,
do you role play when you play role playing games?
I do. I do try to as much as I can. Yeah.
Cool. Me too.
Yeah. I have a tendency to, especially in an RPG, put a lot of emphasis on charisma because I want all the story options, because I'm a writer, so I want all the story options all the time. So I want to get as many. I remember, I don't know if you guys played the game Arcanum. So I love the fact that in that game, it's one of very few games I can think of that respected the character you made to such an extent that you could literally short circuit the final combat by talking the guy out of it. I loved that. You know, you don't have to do it, but the fact that I created a character that 40 hours later, whatever it was, led to the resolution of the character that I wanted just turned my crank. I love that kind of stuff. So
yeah, it makes total sense.
Yeah,
that's great.
Absolutely.
Yeah, Planescape is one of Andrew and I's favorite in that regard.
Yeah, too. So Planescape good. Torment is a game that changed my life. Yeah.
Yep, or it's tremendous, and I'm actually going to, when Torment comes out, I know Pat Rothfuss pretty well, and have been on panels with him and the like, and Pat is doing some of the writing for Torment, and that is his favorite game ever. So I'm going to try to get him on stream around when that thing is actually released, because that is a day one play for me. Torment, Pillars of Eternity is another one, and of course, you know, this one was when it first came out as well. So, okay.
That's great.
Almost done with the third book?
That's a sore subject with him, and he's moving along. I mean, Pat, that's the way that he writes. It's funny.
We understand.
Yeah,
is he George R. R. Martin of RPG.
That he more or less is. He more or less is.
When you do that stream, I'll watch it. I'm a big fan of his work.
Yeah. Pat's an interesting guy. He's got a couple of children's books that have come, well, in quotes, pretend they're not actually for children, but they seem like children's picture books. So we're going to have him on the podcast. I do speculate.
No, that's the way Maurice Sendak used to work. He said he didn't write children's books.
That's right. That's correct. And it's one of the reasons why it's worked so well with everybody, including children, you know, because he didn't just sort of talk down to them. All right.
Unfinish and rum work together?
I think it works beautifully.
All right. Great.
Clearly, we'll have to get these things in. All right. Well, at this point, guys, I am going to start up. I've got this Harfield Manor run. I'm looking forward to getting into combat so I can see some of the differences. But you guys in chat can now feel free to ask some questions of these gentlemen. So if you have one, please just type in all caps question and then colon and then whatever your question is. If you have a question from one of them specifically, again, I'm speaking to from left, your left to the right. Mitch Gittleman is the executive producer at Harebrained Schemes. Mike McCain, who was the art and game lead for Shadowrun Returns Director's Cut, Dragonfall Director's Cut, and then Andrew McIntosh on the right, who was the writer, not just the head writer, but the writer for Dragonfall, which makes him the head writer, and yes, Dragonfall Director's Cut. So if you have a question for one of those guys, Mitch, Mike, or Andrew, just put that in the capital question as well.
By the way, Fishkill, I think what you meant to say is you're playing Dragonfall all week, and then you're downloading Wasteland.
Then you're downloading Wasteland 2 after this?
Just saying.
Yeah, you know, I know a couple of people that were involved initially in Wasteland. The only post-apocalyptic game of any kind that really doesn't, you know, bother me is kind of this game, actually. This is one of the only games that kind of breaks that mold for me, because a lot of them it's too bleak. But something about the way you guys handled the art style and the sort of exuberance of the feel of the, you know, the world is not as depressing for me. So this is a game that I like. Wasteland is, I'm sure it'll be great, but it's not my thing.
Yeah, I'm looking forward to checking it out.
Yeah, absolutely. I'll play it.
All right, so let's get this started.
You guys, A, give us your money, and B, give us your eyeballs for a little while. Can you say that wrong?
Just a bit.
Oh, and hi, Fargo.
All right, give me 1 second while I make a slight adjustment.
Fargo should be in chat.
Good. All right, there we go. Yes, okay. State grounds are silent, save for the faint whistling of the wind. The night is peaceful. You know it won't last. No, it won't. Pleasant illusion that will shatter at the sound of the first gunshot. And Monica Schaefer. What I'm trying to do is I'm looking forward. Of course, I know this story, but I'm looking forward to getting into the combat because I want to start seeing some of the differences here. You ran with her back in the day. Ah, Monica. I have a feeling something... things are not going to go so well for you, Monica. I have a feeling very shortly.
She'll be fine.
You ran with her back in the day. Watched her get her first data jack. So, Glog has a question. Oh, geez. When will you invite Arv to play Golem Arcana? Well, the problem was I didn't think it was quite stream-worthy in the same way. It's so much about the tactile miniatures also that I don't know that it actually works in the same kind of fashion. So, otherwise...
Where are you, Arv?
I'm out in New York City.
I like New York City. Maybe we'll... I'm just saying, you know, tickets aren't that expensive.
Hey, listen, you know, if you swing out here, I mean, it would be, you guys would be more than welcome. I imagine I could get a whole lot of people for something like that. So, yeah, you guys would be more than welcome, of course.
Just saying, not saying.
Yeah. No, that's good. See? There you go, Glog. Glog is in Germany, so you might have a harder time getting over there, but... But anyway, yeah, so, but thank you for the question, Glog. Shane says, question, I'm thinking the arcade game cabinet you talk to the contact on... is based on Tron. That's interesting. Yeah, the arcade game cabinet. Is that a Tron arcade game cabinet?
My lawyer has requested that we can neither confirm nor deny that.
I see. Does it involve a franchise that prominently starred Jeff Bridges?
I don't know if Tron exists in the Shadowrun world.
No, the Shadowrun world started in 2012, technically. So, yeah, it does. Because Tron was 1982.
Shadowrun is in a post-Bridges universe.
Post-Bridges. Wait, I've got an idea for a new IP.
The guy with the words, right?
Right?
Yeah, post-Bridges.
That's right.
I assume that's PB for post-Bridges.
Yes.
Is it 2005 PB? Yeah. I don't know if Jeff Bridges actually ever goes away. I think he's always here in some form or another, really.
Well, he will live on forever in our hearts.
Right, that's what I mean. Let's see. We're on a tight timetable. Want to enter the estate, find the basement, open the data vault, extract the files, and bolt. 10 minutes top to bottom. Ah, Dietrich, who is my favorite, by the way, NPC. As many of my chats said, Dietrich is a bro, as many of my people in chat said. So they all liked him, too. They were fans of Dietrich the bro.
Yes.
I mean,
For those who haven't played it yet, Dietrich's a former punk rocker and shaman of, what is that?
The Dragon right? Slayer.
The Dragon Slayer shaman.
Yes. And
makes
he's,
total sense.
He's a good dude. He's a good dude. Let's see. TR Redskies asks question. Steam HBS engineering samples. Description says there's a real-time combat mod. Is that new or has that always been possible with the editor?
There's a real-time combat mod?
I honestly have no idea. Sheridan put that up earlier today. If he's lurking around, he might be able to field an answer.
Interesting.
Yeah, that is not a thing that is enacted in the Dragonfall Director's Cut, but that is a thing that he's providing for the mod community to play with.
Okay. So you guys are like...
I think so. That's the only reason I can conjure as to why he would put it in there. he's putting it out there for people to look at, so...
We have a very empowered group of people.
I know. It seems like
that. That's another way of saying I had no idea about it.
I have this image. It's, did you mean to make it a Price is Right simulator? What? I had no idea.
That was intentional.
one of our designers says that it was Sheridan's system for testing AI stuff.
I see. Okay. Interesting. Wow. In the workshop made by engineer Sheridan. Oh, very cool. Let's see. Fenrir asks, question. Are you guys working on more DLC incoming for Shadowrun Returns? By the way, I love Dragonfall a lot.
Thank you.
Oh, is this the one that I adroitly sort of...
No. That was another one that I'll try to trick you with later. But
okay.
this one was just a DLC for this.
No, we're not working on more DLC.
I mean, I'll feed him some more alcohol, but I don't know.
Yeah, I know. I was waiting.
All right. Can we get a measure right here? All right. I'll field that one 2 cups from now.
Okay.
Oh, and for the DLC thing, no.
Okay. So as far as you are, that is pretty shit for Dragonfall as the side of things.
No, I meant for Shadowrun Returns specifically. You know, talk to you in a couple of cups.
Okay, excellent. That's what I'm hoping for. Come back and hit me again with that question, Redskies, in a little bit, in about... 5 sips or so. All right, let's see. It should be a milk run. Security is supposed to be light. Incidentally, Andrew, I'll just let you know that when I read security is supposed to be light, it was obvious that this would be a disaster.
As it should be.
Yes.
I mean, the instant someone says it'll be a cakewalk or a milk run, you
right.
know that the world is about to end.
I actually waited for one of them to comment on that and to be like, I can't believe you just said that. You never, ever say that sort of thing. In my experience, there's no such thing as a milk run. Well, okay, so maybe I can't say
that. Yeah, you're the one that gets the comment.
That's the thing. Yeah, I mean, NPCs can say what they will say. We try to give you the agency to rebut that.
Okay. And actually, that does give me a question. Andrew, I guess this may be to you to begin with.
Yeah.
I had a chance to interview Bill Willingham a few weeks ago about Fables, and I tied it into... I was talking to him about his writing, but I also tied it into, because I've played it, The Wolf Among Us, which is that, you know, the Telltale games based on Fables.
Yeah.
And one of the things that he said was when he got the script from them, and he'd never done a game before based on his work, when he got the script from the Telltale guys, first of all, he thought that they had horrible quality control because he thought that they kept repeating lines that they gave to him until they explained that that's how you build a conversation tree. You know, like it's not.
Right.
And he was like, oh, I just thought you guys had, wow, why are you keep repeating the same line?
They might want to train him on the editor next time.
Yeah, no, exactly. But then he went on to say that the thing that was interesting was that to give agency to the player, he had to let go of the character a little bit because there were things that he knew Bigby would never say or do. But he
right.
had to, but it, you know, if you don't let the player choose to say something that he might not have thought that Bigby would say or do, it's not a game at all. You know, then it's just kind
yeah.
of just railroading you through this kind of interactive novel.
Right.
And so I'm curious, Andrew, with you, were there moments where you're like, man, especially now that you're as familiar with these characters as you are, there's not a chance that Glory would say this, or there's not a chance that, you know, Dietrich would do X, Y, or Z. Like, you know, and yet I have to give them the option to say something that seems wrong, you know, to the character in some way.
Well, I generally try to avoid that as much as I can. The way that I look at it, in most of these situations, as in, you know, with any kind of situation where you're doing an illicit job or whatever, you're acting with imperfect information.
Okay.
And so, you know, there are some characters in the group that might say a certain thing that will lead you down a certain path. For other characters, if I feel that they just, you know, in their bones, they would not say this, I try to reword it into something they might say. And then I try to have the player agency based off of that resolve back into the...
What they would say.
Yeah, exactly. Resolve back into the flow of the narrative within a, you know, a beat or two.
I see.
So ideally, I'm not going to put, you know, it's I don't want to have a generic conversation that any of your four potential teammates can say, because, you know, there are things that Blitz would say that Glory just wouldn't. And
oh, they're pretty similar.
Oh, yeah, they're the same person, really.
Yeah.
So yeah, I mean, generally, I try to avoid that. There are places where it is harder to avoid than others. I think part of the, you know, sort of the artifice of doing, of writing conversation trees is finding ways that feel a little more organic to resolve those conflicts.
Yeah. Okay.
Which sometimes definitely creates more work as far as like...
Oh, it absolutely
does.
What
do you mean sometimes to navigate conversation? I mean, but it's worth it.
Yeah, I mean, the thing is that there's absolutely an art to it, because the more agency you give to the player early on that you don't resolve back into the flow of the main narrative, the more your conversation tree becomes a bush. And the bushier it gets, the more work.
Where's this going, Andrew?
But what I'm saying is the
PG audience.
The more it spreads out in the beginning, the more work you have to do to resolve it by the end.
Yeah, right.
All of those branches, while they're wonderful player agency, your players will only ever see one branch unless they play a bunch of times, and most people aren't going to play 30 times to see all the branches if it gets too branchy at the beginning.
Yeah. Yeah.
So, a lot of the art of it is, I think, writing conversations that feel organic, that feel like, you know, the words that are coming from these characters are things that they would say, that and making you feel as though you have the appropriate amount of agency without you spending 4 days working on one conversation that nobody will ever see all of.
Yeah, that's true. Yeah. And
the other thing I'll just add to that is, we definitely have the advantage of we've crafted these characters for this campaign, for these situations that we want them to encounter.
Right.
Just since you mentioned the Fable example, right? Like, whereas dealing with a character that was created, you know, that has so much legacy already attached, then that was a somewhat different challenge, at least for them.
Right, there's that moment, I think, in Dead Man's Switch where they run into, and forgive me because I'm not super, super up on the Shadowrun lore beyond what I've got from these games, but the character that, oh gosh, he's a famous Shadowrun character that are mentioned in the novels. He wears sunglasses.
Jake.
And, sorry?
Oh, Jake. Yeah, Jake Armitage.
Yes, Jake Armitage, right. That was kind of a cool Easter egg, it felt to me, because I remember when I encountered him, I had heard vaguely of the name, but my chat went berserk. Like, oh, it's Armitage, bro, Jake Armitage. And I was like, well, okay. So they all knew about it, and I guess that was a cool Easter egg, but presumably if you had tried to build a game around him, you're going to be bouncing off lore issues all over the place, I would think. I mean, or at least you have to kind of be conscious of decisions that were made in the past about him or using him, as opposed to constructing a new story in the world, but with these characters from the ground up. Is that fair to say? I mean,
Jake in particular is a little easier because Jake only appeared in the Super Nintendo game.
Okay.
He's actually not part of Shadowrun canon.
Okay.
Whereas somebody like Harlequin, if you remember him, from near the end of Dead Man's Switch.
Yes.
He's a more famous character in Shadowrun, and so we had to be more careful around him.
I gotcha. Okay. So let's see. UGE Plex asked the question, are there other scripts and storylines that were seriously considered and almost produced for Return/Dragonfall, and can we hear about one?
I'll start with...
Hi, RC.
Hey! So, Ugaplex. So to start with, on Dead Man's Switch, the story that Jordan came up with for Dead Man's Switch was brilliant and vast, is the best way to put it, I think. It had these two really interesting storylines that were connected in very interesting ways that wove its way through Shadowrun canon. And he did a great job of doing that weaving in and out of different novels and source books and stuff like that. And so there's a lot of that story, frankly, that's on the cutting room floor.
Hmm. I see. That's interesting. Which
we
will...
Now, for Dragonfall, I don't believe there was pretty much any of that, because once we cut our teeth on Dead Man's Switch, it was much easier. You know, a V2 of anything is easier than V1. Trust me on that one.
Mm-hmm.
So we had a much clearer idea of like how much work goes into conversation trees and supporting exactly. the different choices that we want to offer to the player.
Yeah.
And I suppose understanding the engine as well. I mean, you know, the sort of limitations.
Oh my God,
for sure, yeah. Or actually having the engine.
Yeah. Remember, when you're building an engine and building the game simultaneously.
In Returns, it was like everything we were developing a lot of things for the first time, right? And I think it was a...
When you have a mature feature set and tool set, it's much easier to make a game.
Yeah. And I certainly enjoy the advantage of all of that having been done by the time that I signed on. All of my audition work was done in the editor, which these guys were building while they were working on Dead Man's Switch. Mm-hmm. So for me, I'd played Dead Man's Switch, and, you know, it's like I was able to, you know, I was able to do the work in the editor that they had designed, but they had to design that editor while they were writing the game.
Yeah, I wouldn't wish that on anybody. But I got to tell you, I remember the day that Mike and I played Andrew's audition. I remember very, very well. We were playing it on Mike's PC, and we had gone through several audition pieces, and in general, we went like this. And we played Andrew's, and we got... just a few sentences in, and we looked at each other like, this is the guy.
This was unsolicited too.
Yeah it was really easy to choose Andrew.
Oh, nice.
Oh yeah,
which is the way to do it, by the way.
We giggled our way through his audition piece. Oh my God, this guy gets it.
Yeah. Yeah,
that's
funny.
Really easy.
It wasn't one of those situations where you get the, you know, there were a thousand, it was very close decision. It was clearly this guy was the
and in my experience also, sometimes you choose the best of the worst.
Mm-hmm.
And it was not that at all this time. It was just, oh, the skies parted and Andrew descended from heaven.
Then we actually met him in person. But...
And it turns out...
That's generally the way I try to make an entrance.
Yeah. Once he's in the room, though, it's a very different animal. Oh, by the way, I'm empty.
Allow me to pour you some more of my expensive rum.
There you go.
All right, Shane asks a question, actually comments.
Cheers.
One, thank you for going turn-based combat with the SR games. Two, although it was cool to have a team of companions with unfolding backstory in Dragonfall, I actually enjoyed the story from Dead Man's Switch more due to the noir feel. Yeah, it's interesting. He says, not to say Dragonfall wasn't a good story. Interesting. You know what, Shane? I have to say, personally, I like Dead Man's Switch. But man, like Dragonfall pushed all the buttons for me. I mean, it was this sort of complex, deep, involving story. I love the multiple storylines. I mean, one of my first loves is epic fantasy, so it, you know, the epic nature of it kind of tied in. So I liked Dead Man's Switch, but I there was certainly, I don't know, I'm more of an epic guy than a noir guy anyway, but I felt more like I was allowed to sort of make choices and take on things in the way I wanted, and Dead Man's Switch was a little, as I think you guys would agree, a little bit more, you know, directed, right? I mean, you're sort of, there are fewer choices or fewer options that you've got to work
directed, with. Directed is one word, linear is another word.
Well, I was, you know.
Just right. Calling the spade a spade, it's okay. You know, that comes down to game development. And, you know, we were developing, as we said before, we were developing the engine, developing the tools. And, you know, we did what we did at the time and we're very proud of it, but we're very proud of how we were able to take that and evolve it.
Yeah. Let's see. UG Plex says, question, can you release or share with us Andrew's audition piece?
We can and we have. It's basically
did
when you
we
go
really?
Talk to Glory.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, actually, that's true.
Yeah. If you chat with Glory, that's his
audition
piece.
In the game.
Yeah, the first couple stages of her conversations you can have with her are basically straight from that audition.
Yeah, cool.
But let's, you know, Andrew touched it up.
Yeah, there was a bit of touch-up. Yeah, Glory was the audition piece, and,
So, I just got into combat, so this is a good chance for you guys to tell me a little bit about the differences here.
Excellent.
And the UI. Oh, I see some already, but you tell me, like, what are the things that I'll notice, or a player who's played the old one and then this would notice about this?
Sure, yeah. So, right off the bat, I guess I'll start with mechanics. Cover is a lot more important. In the director's cut now.
Okay.
And we've added some new UI to sort of message that to the player clearer. So not only does cover affect your two hit on an enemy, but medium and heavy cover is also going to mean that the target cannot take critical hits at all.
Oh, wow, nice.
And then you get around that by taking a flanking shot or catching targets that are out in the open. So looking for those opportunities has become a lot more important. On the flip side, if you're not in cover, or if the enemy, or if the improved AI is, thinks to flank around your position, you're going to take a lot more damage. So one thing that's nice about that is it gives you a lot more risk-reward opportunities in combat. When you move your characters out, especially with melee characters, you can get around the enemy's cover and really take advantage of that system at the risk of potentially leaving yourself more exposed. And on your side, receiving damage, if you take a solid cover position, then you have a much more reliable expectation of how much damage you're going to take, because if you're in medium or heavy cover, you're not going to get hit by any surprise crits from bad guys that completely drop your health, right? You know you're only going to take so much.
Gotcha. With a couple of notable exceptions, grenades can still do it if they're tossed.
Yeah, there's always exceptions, yeah, right? Yeah. That's what makes it tactical. There's right, never exactly. A guaranteed solution.
Right, and that works for you as well. I mean, you know, someone's in cover, toss a grenade behind him, and the damage is coming from a place where he's not in cover.
Yeah.
So that can crit. Another important thing to note is the white pips above the health bars.
Yes.
Those are armor. Those are, so the armor system now provides a straight damage mitigation equal to the number of pips that you've got. So,
okay.
So you've got four pips of armor, that's 4 points of damage reduced from every attack. And if you're in heavy cover and you have a fair amount of armor, you'll find a number of attacks that get blocked completely. You take zero damage from them.
Oh, wow.
But we do have attacks that strip armor.
The pierce armor.
Yeah. So armor piercing is for that attack. Armor stripping is for subsequent attacks.
I see.
Subsequent?
Yes. I use big words. I'm a writer.
I thought it was subsequent. But I know it's written subsequent.
Well, hey, I'm a writer. I don't pronounce things.
Fair enough.
That's for other people. Yeah, so, and then all that sort of wraps
subsequent?
Up into the...
Whatever.
Just saying. It's almost...
It was subsequent after a few glasses of the rum, right?
So it's, yeah, exactly. So all of this kind of comes together in the new UI.
What's
so...
drinking?
I'm trying to talk about our game.
Oh, I'm sorry. Please continue.
Anyways, yeah, so we wanted to make things a little more accessible and take advantage of widescreen displays better, so you can see the new ability bar at the bottom. It shows all of your weapon abilities and your spells and items that you have equipped all in one place.
Which means you don't have to click through other UI elements to get to it, and you can see everything right on top.
Yep.
Yeah. I might need to call you back on the computer, by the way, now that it seems to be working again.
Okay.
My phone's about to die.
Okay, sure, that's fine. That's fine.
Or do you want to call me? What's easier?
I can do either one. And then I have a question that chat just asked as well. Do you want me to call you back right now? Or?
Yeah, why don't you just give me a call? I'm going to hang this up and then, yeah, just call right back.
Okay, sounds good. All right, so give us 1 second, guys, while we get them back. Thank you guys again. You're watching an interview, exclusive interview with Mitch Gittleman, Andrew McIntosh, and Mike McCain, and I am playing through a little bit of the director's cut. So far, I'm happy with the director's cut because I just took that guy down, so I feel like, you know, I feel like they clearly made the tweaks properly. Thousands more likely. Okay. Let me see if I can call him now.
Is it Chasm or Chorn? Is it
Chasm?
Because I always replace. I always called it.
These guys are debating pronunciation still. Are we back?
Chasm versus Chasm. Are we on the air?
Yeah, you are on the air, and it's Chasm, oh. As far as I know.
Yeah, we agree, but the 14-year-old us may disagree.
I see. Well, so one of the questions that got asked, first of all, Shane says, makes a comment that he really loves the art style in his games and is impressed with both of them. I agree with that, as I've said before. I am going to want to ask Mike in a minute if there's other art, like assets around here that I might notice that are different. But before I do that, Gus Ack asked, what is your favorite spell? I'm wondering, I guess that's maybe for all of you guys. Do you have a favorite spell?
Well, how do you choose among your children?
Well, mine's easy. It's haste. I like casting haste on Lori or Iger and just having a million AP to kill people.
Well, I threw a little shout out to second edition, first and second edition Shadowrun in in the narrative, Zach Flash at one point sort of intimates that he had cast Turn to Goo on somebody.
Yeah, bravo.
The most ridiculous and overpowered and eventually redacted spell in Shadowrun history.
Well, and you'll notice Ecstasy does not appear in Shadowrun Returns or Dragonfall. It's only a geek could create a spell where you cause an orgasm in a person and it's a touch-based spell.
Yeah, that's...
You would think it would at least be ranged.
No.
It'd be ranged.
It's nighttime on the East Coast.
Yes, yes. It's after dark. It's Arv after dark, yes.
After dark.
That should be totally fine. I've got the mature tag up.
watching this.
So let's see. We've got... Yes. Will you guys question? Will you guys ever release an add-on? Well, that's a spoiler, Fenrir. That's a spoiler. Which I'm going to purge. Not because I don't like you, I do, but just because I don't want anyone who hasn't seen that and hasn't played this to know the answer to that question. So I will not pass that on to them. They may have seen it already, but I don't wanna spoil it for anybody.
I'm not wearing my glasses, so I can't see.
You couldn't tell anyway. Let's see. UGE says, comment, some of the small details I really love in SR Dragonfall are things like the artwork graffiti near the phone booth in the Kreutz Bazaar and walking through a stock of birds and they all take off, fly away, plus the skittering roaches. Yeah, I agree with that, and I felt that even with the Dead Man Switch. I really loved the sort of the background environments, again, really vibrant and alive and moving as well. Let's see. Messiah asks, question on the art. Is it me or are the colors more washed out in the DC edition? Also, can I marry Glory? As far as marrying Glory, I'd say there's a risk there. I'd say. But I'll let these guys answer that about the colors. I don't know that I noticed that per se. I don't know. Is there was there any adjustment made with the colors or...
No comment on Glory.
She is make believe.
You don't need to destroy their dreams. That's not. There's no.
So we have added some post processing in Dragonfall, which is optional. It does desaturate just a little bit. Mm. It also adds a little bit of light bloom. I forget what else I threw in there to be honest.
Well, uncheck the checkbox.
It softens up some of the lighting a little bit. Yeah.
I think the purpose of that, right, was to make the vibrant colors pop more by having them not against such a garish background. But if you don't like it, again, you can absolutely open options and turn off post processing.
So you just said not make garish backgrounds. Is that garish or is that garish?
I just took out post process just to see. Let's see. This game makes me want to try out the Shadowrun pen and paper RPG. Well, a lot of people really love that.
That absolutely.
Yeah, it's a great game.
Yeah, absolutely.
One of the great joys, real fast, of my, I was going to say childhood, that's not, one of the great joys of college was playing Shadowrun with the original line developer of Shadowrun and the guy who created Harlequin, Tom Dowd. And if you remember from Dead Man Switch, Dowd is dead. That's who that is. Hmm. So, yeah, please shout out Shadowrun pen and paper tabletop. Play that.
Yep. I got my start playing pen and paper when I was in junior high school, I think.
Easy now.
Yeah. No, I'm looking at you, Matt.
Yeah.
Yes, you are.
I don't know what you guys
are talking about. And funny enough, when I was growing up in Southern California, all of my friends and I were, you know, we would sit around playing Shadowrun thinking, God, it would be so cool to move to Seattle. And then the GM...
Where these people all were, you know, like all these things.
Yeah. So and so after college, the GM from those games moved to Seattle. And then moved into his house. So.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. So
that's cool. What's funny is that, you know, when Shadowrun was written, nobody had been to Seattle except Jordan's sister. And
really?
Jordan's sister, one weekend, he's like, oh, we should make a game here. So what you'll see is the travel times from Tacoma to Seattle are completely wrong. Jordan had never actually driven from Tacoma to Seattle. Stuff like that. It's just like, well, what does my sister think it is?
The future. Cars are faster.
Oh, yeah.
That's funny. Yeah, my wife is, I actually have, my in-laws are from Seattle, so I have been out there a few times, and, it seems that it caught that feel very well. Was there anyone on the team who had gone to Berlin before making this, or?
Oh yeah, we sent the entire team to Berlin.
Can we go back and have the version of history where that happened?
That would have been awesome.
It would have been great. Yeah.
Actually, we did have a member of our engineering team, Garrett, went to Berlin for a family trip a few months ago.
He sent us pictures.
Well, which was nice.
Yeah, my wife is half German, and so...
Which half, by the way?
Her father is German, and so I...
Just didn't take that bait, did he?
No. and so I mean I've never been to Germany. I don't speak German, but you know, it was helpful to have someone who knows the country's, you know, living under my roof and to be able to consult a bit.
So we also, while we're on that topic, we added a fantastic consultant that works on a lot of the Shadowrun mm-hmm. Germany products named Andreas.
Yep.
His screen name is Robin AAS. I don't know if I'm pronouncing it right, but I'm pretty sure that's what it is. Anyways, he was incredibly generous with his time. He played through the entire campaign and told us where we were screwing up all of our German and our location information and all that good stuff. And it would not be as faithful to the city or to the setting.
Yeah, it was incredibly helpful to have him as a consultant on a product. So.
Interesting. And were there thoughts, let's see, I don't know if you're enough sips in now, Mitch, that you can, you might be able to answer this question now, but, you know, I know that other Shadowrun fans have asked for other locales. There's been talk of, I think maybe Chicago or Denver, actually, I think I remember hearing coming up, and I'm curious if, those might be, you know, on your radar screen. I mean, not in any way would this be publicly available to everyone, when you announced this stuff, you know, so, if I don't know if there's any information that you'd like to give us about that.
We're very interested in... Thank you very much, Andrew.
Yep.
We're very interested in making more Shadowrun. We can neither confirm nor deny any location information. But what we do know... Un poco. Just drain it. Drain it.
Hey, Mitch, I have a question. Is Robin still here, and is she driving?
Man, I hope so. Robin is our community manager and my wife.
Yes.
And my designated driver, which is awesome. I assume she's here because I have the keys to the car, which is awesome, which I will hand over, especially considering all the cough medicine I had before I started drinking. But to answer your question even a little bit, we adore Shadowrun, and even though we've got a lot of things we want to make, we want to make more Shadowrun. And although I've dodged the question a number of times, you know, the number one thing that we hear is, hey, Shadowrun Dragonfall Director's Cut with a colon and a dash.
Yeah.
Just wonderful, we love it, but we want more content. We want more content,
mm-hmm.
and we want to make more content.
Okay.
And so the key thing for us is really, now that we've sunk our teeth into how to tell a Shadowrun story, is how do we play with storytelling? And we really want to explore storytelling in Shadowrun. So I can tell you today, officially and definitively, we want to make more Shadowrun content, and we intend to make more Shadowrun content, and we intend on exploring sort of storytelling mechanisms and size and scope. So we're working diligently right now on what comes next.
Awesome. So that is news, people in chat, that there is in fact more in the works, that they would want to make more in the works. And actually, the last time, Mitch, I know that when we had this discussion, it was not yet clear whether or not there had been enough sort of community interest and involvement and so on to justify costs and you know, everything else.
Yeah.
Is it fair to say that question has been largely resolved, that you think there is enough?
For me, as an executive producer, as a businessman, it's been resolved.
Okay.
People have embraced Shadowrun, have embraced Dragonfall in a really great way, and from what we're seeing today, they're embracing the director's cut. And so we're very, very interested in making more Shadowrun content. We're very excited to make more Shadowrun content.
Which is really good. That's really good news.
I'm unwilling to Shadowrun.
Yeah. No, I mean, it's really good news too, because, you know, the I mean, obviously the mods can do a whole bunch of stuff. You know, people can mod in great stuff and they can do their own campaigns.
Oh my God. Great stuff.
Yeah. But having said that, there's something about the folks who were there, you know, sitting there with the engine, who can just... I really should not have done what I just did, but oh well. This is what happens when I'm interviewing and playing the game at the same time. I just realized that what I did was incredibly stupid. But it feels like, you know, when you guys are the ones writing, sitting there,
sorry,
it really
I would
does.
Sign up right now, if I were you.
Cover is a good idea.
Covers right now is a great idea.
Yeah. Well, I did get in there, but the problem is I wanted to use my eagle totem first, and I didn't because I anyway. But yeah. So I guess the question would be, or not the question, but just the comment is that it helps to have the ones who are actually working with it and live and breathe it all the time. Those folks, you know, doing that stuff, you know, it makes a difference. Even the best amateur campaign stuff, often I find, still has something that's a little bit off from the main, you know, the kind of what the professional guys are able to do, just because they're with it all the time. So,
yeah, I think that's a great way of putting it, is that we're with it all the time. You know, Jordan and I have done a lot of Let's Plays, and you should look at our YouTube channel for those Let's Plays. And we also do something called Shadow Labs, which is when we play people's user-generated content and actually give them feedback and how to improve that.
Mm-hmm.
There's been some really, really fun content out there, but it's not so much that we're closer to it, it's we have more time to devote to
it. Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. It's a lot easier to tell a compelling Shadowrun story when you're getting paid to do it.
Bravo. Yeah. And you actually have, you know, 60, 80 hours a week to do it.
Exactly. Exactly.
Talking about our 9 to 5.
Yes. 9 to 5, bitch.
Yes. Fallen, one of my moderators in chat, says, damn it.
Jordan and I giggle our way through user generated content. It's so much fun to play stuff that people have taken your tools and you know, the world that Jordan was a major part of creating. And seeing them just run with it.
Yeah.
Man, we giggle our asses off when we play that stuff.
No, I bet. It is pretty wild to have something that was, you know, you guys worked with and made that just gets taken and they just take the ball and run with it. That is really cool. That said though, I'm glad you guys are on the job. and also, by the way, I don't know if you noticed, but actually Robin has said yes, you have a ride. So you're okay, Mitch. Yeah. So,
and to my
safe.
Children, of course I had a dedicated driver.
Goodness. These well-respected business folks here.
Dedicated.
Let's see. Shane says he's rooting for Hoboken. Yeah, I don't think, I'm guessing.
Oh, Hoboken! FTW!
Messiah asks, is it a spoiler to ask how many new endings there are compared to the original Dragonfall? I don't know, maybe not. Probably not.
Yeah, there are two major diversions from the original.
So two more or two total now? Like
two in
more.
Addition.
Oh, two in addition. Oh, wow. Yeah. How much of that is determined earlier?
Differently now.
Okay. Okay.
Without,
how much?
Yeah, there are some things that a lot of people wish that they could say or make happen towards the end of the game, and we've made a couple of those things possible.
Yeah. And to be fair, I mean to be. Truthful, these are things that we wished that we could have done as well. It's just that we hit a point where it was like, we would need to put in the time to do it right.
Yeah.
You know?
Every branching choice in a game like this has a compounded cost.
Right. I mean, it doesn't do anyone any favors if we put in an extra ending that isn't satisfying.
Right.
So.
Right. And I actually think, is the ending, this is something which I've heard people talk about in regards to the Mass Effect franchise. Is the ending something that, you know, decisions that you make in hour, I don't know, 5, affect what ultimately happens, other than the obvious, you know, if you go one direction, if you go left instead of right, it might make a change. But I'm wondering if decisions you made back then will come back to, I don't know, haunt you or be happy for you in the end or not.
I will say that for one of the two new major endings, things that you do much earlier in the game will tie into it.
So there's a lot of retrofitting involved with that. I mean, not even retrofitting, but just, you know, a lot of sort of did you have to do a lot of like working back through and going, okay, this is going to match up with it? I mean, I'm thinking about sort of breaking down a choose your own adventure book and shuffling it up and having to redo it again, basically.
There was a pretty fair amount of that. I mean, it was anytime that you take that you approach an undertaking like this, you need to look at where you need to organically add things to make the ending culmination feel the way it should. And then you need to make sure that those things that you're doing along the way don't break anything.
Mm-hmm. Right.
When you add all of that work with our joy in giving the people that bought Dragonfall, Dragonfall Director's Cut for free, I think what you'll see is that we're lousy businessmen, but we're loving game developers.
Just describe yourself as a
businessman. I said a lousy businessman.
Is that the new slogan? Like, love game development, lousy businessman.
Lousy businessman, loving game developers. TM.
That'll actually work very well for your business, because I think most gamers would approve of that combination, frankly.
But screw it. Game developers first, businessmen way second.
Yeah. Well, fair enough, and it is amazing how much of this still gets done for the love of it, you know, not just, you know, cash flow. Let's see, UGE asks, with Microsoft owning the Shadowrun video game IP rights, and I don't know actually if that's totally accurate, but have they shown any interest? Is that accurate? All of it? Okay. Have they shown any interest in doing more from their side, or with you guys, now that HBS has proven Shadowrun really is a viable franchise?
May I?
I think you must.
I must. So having spent many, many years at Microsoft, first of all, Microsoft has been extremely supportive of us and really approves of what we're doing. What was your question again?
Do they want to do more stuff?
Do they want to do more stuff? They have given us pretty much carte blanche to do whatever we want because they really believe in us. I spent many years in Microsoft, many years at Microsoft's game studios. Jordan spent much less in Microsoft game studios, but we know those people and there's a lot of mutual respect and they've treated us extremely well. And they're just letting us do what we want, which I really, really appreciate.
Yeah, no, for sure. Yeah. Let's see, Fenrir asks, when Dragonfall was under development, did dual-wield melee ranged weapons come up as an option? If yes, can you elaborate on what made you opt not to do it? There's a loaded question, Mike.
I know, I've heard about the dual-wield question before. It's like, I can't believe you didn't do dual-wield. Mike, why didn't you do dual-wield? What's the matter with you?
Dual-wield is not something that came up a whole lot. I think we've got a pretty well-balanced weapon set right now, and to add to it with a totally new thing like dual wield is a pretty significant undertaking, both from an animation standpoint and from a game balancing standpoint. I think dual wielding's pretty cool,
absolutely.
But at the end of the day, when we're looking at you know, a grid full of features and engineering time, we were looking at other things like the combat improvements that we found to be a bigger bang for our buck.
Right, and I mean, it's worth mentioning that anything we do like dual wield has an engineering cost, and if we spend the time having engineers work on dual wield, that means they're not doing something else.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Okay.
So,
I already saw some of the blood effects that you guys have added in.
Yummy.
So that was
nice. Was one of the very first feedback we ever got on Shadowrun Returns was more gore.
Yeah, absolutely. And now Glory can tear people's legs off. So there you go.
Link you guys to a couple GIFs. I can't say that. I feel like it's a loaded word, but we've got some playing of the blood effects. I'll show you here. So.
Oh my gosh, his throwing knives do damage now. Amazing. Excellent. It's my one problem
it's
with my bro.
It's things in life.
Okay, as you're linking those, Shane says, comment, I can't say enough how much I enjoy the turn-based combat. I went into the editor and made scenarios just for the sheer turn-based carnage of it all. Kudos. Glog asks, Glog is not only from Germany, but is our resident Linux guy who always wants to know about Linux stuff. So he asks, which Unity version is Director's Cut on, and do you plan on moving it up to Unity 5?
I believe we're on 4.34 right now. Don't quote me on that, though. You know, certainly Unity upgrades is something that comes up, because they update fairly frequently, comes up fairly frequently. At the end of the day, when you've got such an established product like Shadowrun is so much built on top of it, you're always trying to look at both, well, what did they actually add in that version? Are there fixes that we need? And then what else might break? Because things are changing, things that we've built on.
That last part is the key, right?
Yes.
Whenever you, because we've done this before, when you upgrade to a new version of X software, you're looking at unintended consequences, and so you got to be really careful about that.
So I think it's unlikely, all things considered, that we'll bump Shadowrun up to Unity 5 in the near future. We are looking at it for some other projects.
Okay, excellent. Question, are there plans from UGE, are there plans for a Shadowrun theme based on Golem Arcana? Because I would throw even more money and a monkey at you for it, although I love Golem Arcana 2 anyway, so much tabletop fun.
So could you, what did he say?
He's asking for a Shadowrun variant of Golem Arcana. So the Golem Arcana board game, but with Shadowrun as the IP.
Oh, I can answer that from a business perspective, no.
That's too much, huh? That's too harebrained?
No, it's too much. It's that I don't want to share the money with Microsoft. Next question.
Yes. Let's all try to not share money from Microsoft if we can, people. Microsoft didn't buy Twitch, okay? This is Amazon that bought Twitch, so you're good. Dragonspear, question. Did you find that Unity...
Wait. It got Minecraft.
They got Minecraft, that's true.
Minecraft,
and people are already upset the minute they picked it up.
But you said Shadowrun Minecraft yet.
Oh, that's true. Shadowrun Minecraft. Yeah. That would be interesting. I'm trying to think of what it would involve. Shadowrun Minecraft.
Hi, everybody.
Hi, Rebecca.
That's water. So
everybody say hi to Rebecca, who's also the producer here.
Thank you, Rebecca.
Bye, guys.
Bye-bye.
So you guys are chasing the run. Are you sure that's water? Is that just water? Is that?
It's just water.
Yeah, absolutely.
Not straight vodka.
We're in Seattle. Who knows what kind of
who knows what it is.
In here.
Dragon Spirit asks, did you find that Unity had any limitations that prevented you from implementing something in game? If so, what was that?
We don't believe in limitations. Next question.
All right, there you go. No limitations ever. UGE Plex, as for Andrew specifically, now that Catalyst Game Labs is publishing Shadowrun novels again, might you write one? Especially since I am very good friends with the editor for that anthology line, John Helfer. So,
Helfers, you know Helfers.
Well, I know John. That's me. I edited that part in. I know John very well.
Actually, tell him to approach me, and we can check off.
I'm not at all against the idea. I will say that I have a 4-month-old daughter at home, and so between writing games and caring for a newborn and being with my wonderful wife, hi Elisa, there's not a ton of extra time. But I'm not at all opposed to the idea of.
Yeah, he's already shipped two products.
Yeah.
Yeah. Mm. And by the way, Andrew has named his daughter Glory.
Her name is Monica.
Pronounced Glory. It's written Monica.
But it's pronounced Glory. Where all the letters in Monica are silent.
Monica and...
it's written Monica, but it's pronounced Manika, according to the way you
saw it. I did not want her to have to go through life explaining that it's Monica with a K.
So the weather's been... weird lately.
Fenrir has a question. Fenrir has a question. I'm sorry. Go ahead, Andrew. I'm sorry. After you.
Not at all against the idea of writing a novel. It'd be a lot of fun. But as of right now, there is not a ton of time for anything other than being a dad and writing games.
Okay.
What Andrew's trying to say is he's fully burdened.
As we speak.
Burden has a negative.
Let's see. Fender asks, question, were there new animations for sword attacks added, and is there a scythe now, a cyberpunk Grim Reaper's dream?
Nice. There are no scythes. I'm sorry to report. There's a lot of new animations. I can't confidently say right now whether the sword attack was one of them, but we definitely went.
No, there was no. It was pommel strike.
There's definitely new sword attacks. Yeah. There's new sword attack abilities. I'm pretty sure. We did a pretty extensive animation task to identify places where we wanted to either give some new abilities custom animations or spend a little more time to iterate on stuff that was already in.
Okay. Let's see. We have, from Forlaren. And by the way, everyone, welcome into my stream. We're about closing in about 60 people now. This is the folks at Harebrained Schemes. Mitch Gittleman, Mike McCain, Andrew McIntosh, who are respectively the executive producer, the art and game lead, and the lead writer on Shadowrun Returns, Dragonfall. This is the director's cut, which just released today. And as always, I'm having a great time talking to these guys about their art, and that is clearly what this is. So Forlaren asks, is there any chance we can get a start turn based mode button? Why does my decker always need to open the door? I don't entirely know that I understand that question.
Decker is your player character and you're not in turn mode, your decker's gonna open the door.
It was something we talked about. To enact such a major change to the infrastructure of the game system, it proved to be out of scope.
We had major changes.
We're
more than enough going.
Absolutely. I mean, there were the change to the UI, the change to the armor system, a bunch of changes that occurred to the editor that made the game easier and more streamlined for myself and the designers to create.
Yeah.
These all had to take priority, and we really want to be able to enable turn-based mode at any time, but it was a sort of a choice of do that or do all of these other things we needed to get this product done.
All of game development involves value judgments, and that's unfortunate, but that's what it is.
Yeah. Let's see. Fishkill asks, any plans for controller support? Someone just mentioned the new UI is similar to XCOM. It is. And I would love to play from the couch. I mean, I use XPattern. It's fairly simple, but an XCOM-style pathing system would be fantastic and open up the possibility for consoles if interested. But actually, Andrew, before we even went live, you said that this is available. There is a console this is available on, no?
I didn't see that.
Did someone mention that, or...?
Can we get the playback on that, please?
Yeah, maybe I'm wrong. Maybe I'm wrong. Is there a console planning at all in this, or did I maybe dream that?
No, it does run all right on a Steam box with a Steam controller. I wouldn't necessarily say it's the ideal way to experience the game, but it's completely playable, and it's on par with playing another kind of turn-based game, I guess, on consoles.
Okay. Yeah, I mean, for me, I'm more of a PC guy, but I do have consoles. Playing this on controller would be odd. I don't know. Mouse keyboard seems just very logical for this sort of a game, but I know a lot of people love controllers. Hi, Thor. Welcome in. Shane asks, question, if I clue the devs in on my favorite fake German phrase, will they work it into the director's premium Game of the Century edition cut?
Yes, we will.
Yes, they'll absolutely do that if you can clue them into this thing. What is this thing, Shane? What are you speaking about?
Yeah, let's go.
Transition to a new location.
By this point, we've shipped three more games. Let's go.
That's true. Let's see. Hey, what's up, Lakota? Hi. Let's see. So far, so good. Skirmish with security. What else are we gonna mention? Was there stuff that in practice when you released it in Dragonfall? You felt like, yeah, this didn't work the way we hoped for, and you were able to remove it. I know you said it was more additive than otherwise, but I'm wondering if there was anything that, in practice, once enough people had given you feedback on it, outside of the beta testing system, there was a point where you're like, yeah, this just didn't work the way we intended, or not.
I'm not sure. I mean, one thing that we really love about Andrew here is he's an extremely iterative writer, and so the way that our process works is we go a lot of rounds with all the sort of important story beats and character moments and all that. So we really get a lot of eyes on that early and sort of know how these things are going to play because we we've already done that, that might work.
And from a gameplay point of view, I can't think of anything that was like, wish we hadn't done that.
I mean, certainly there's stuff we wanted to make better, which was one of the reasons why we did this combat mechanics overhaul.
Yeah.
Right,
absolutely. And you know, I mean, there are a number of things that we did improve in that way. You know, I think that the first encounter with a individual that you're about to meet has been improved substantially.
Oh, yeah.
The thing he's about to meet.
The thing I'm about to meet.
I mean, spoilers on something that came out in February.
Spoilers on something that's going to happen in about a minute.
That's correct.
Monica's looking really
good. She is.
Yeah, she looks great.
She just looks really alive.
Let's see. Shane, by the way, Shane's message, Shane's fake German is Ich Lubenstein. He said he made it up while visiting Heidelberg. It sounded very German, but he got puzzled looks. So, let's see.
No.
Glock 78, my actual German, is appalled that he would even bring this up. So, I don't, you know.
Nice.
Yes. Let's see. UG Plex asks, speaking of controllers, now this is interesting to me because I actually have one of these. Will the Android version of Dragonfall finally support the Galaxy Note 2, 3, 4 tablet styluses? Please, fingers are too fumbly at times. I have a Galaxy Note 2, actually. I hadn't even thought about that, but... can it support the stylus? It maybe.
I have no idea.
Oh, I remember that question. I've gotten that before.
I don't know, but it's something we'll look into.
Yeah, that's kind of neat. I hadn't even thought about it, but I could see a lot of possibilities for that. Are there possibilities, Messiah asks, are there possibilities of UGC support on the tablet versions of the game? UGC.
No, there's not, because the Shadowrun editor is a complex beast. And trying to make Shadowrun stuff content happen on the iPad, I wouldn't want to do it. Don't ask for it. You don't want that. You don't want that.
You don't want any of that.
You don't want that.
Let's see. Pro.
You don't want that.
Decisions made, you have your answer. Acknowledged. Yep. This is the section. It took me a while to warm up to Iger. There was a whole state of point where I was kind of like, Iger, I'm tired of your nonsense. She came around, of course. We came around at the end.
You made her come around.
Yeah. That's true. Let's see. Legitimate concern. All right, let's get this done. See you on the other side.
You know, a lot of people love Glory. I love Iger. Iger's my favorite character.
Interesting. Oh, I can see that.
Absolutely. No, Iger is Iger. And I wish she was my PC. I love Iger.
Yeah. I've seen a fair amount of that. It's interesting to see sort of the split of who is whose favorite character, you know, where people lie in that regard. I mean, a lot of love for Dietrich, a lot of love for Iger, a lot of love for Glory. One thing that people seem to really enjoy about Iger is that I think that Iger and Dietrich are the two characters in the game who don't need you to do anything for them. I mean, they're there and they do their own thing and they have strong opinions about stuff. Dietrich needs your help more than Iger does.
Mm-hmm.
You know, she's of all of the companions with you, she's the one who, in her mind at least, is closest to being an equal with you.
Yep.
And so needs the least from you.
Yep. She reminds me of my daughters.
Mm. Mm. Interesting.
Poor daughters.
Daunting is my favorite.
Yes, this is where stuff hit the fan, as it were. Let's see.
Right here.
It's a flesh
one. No, it's okay. It'll be fine.
Let's see. Yeah, it's just a flesh one, yeah. Messiah throws money. Fallen also throws money. Yeah, they're throwing a lot of money, you guys. Let's see. UGB Plex asks, question, not the editor, but will loading UGC to play on mobile devices be possible at some point?
It's unlikely at this point.
Okay.
It's just a matter of, you know, we're a very small studio and it's where we put our resources.
Mm-hmm. Let's see. And yeah, actually, I should ask that too. I should know this already, but this is available on Steam. It's available on tablet through Android, right? I'm sorry, through what?
Tablet versions are coming later this year.
Okay, there are tablet versions. And that will include iPads as well? Or are we talking...
Oh, absolutely.
Okay, so iOS, okay. Is that... What kind of a challenge has that been? I guess, Mike, I assume you're heading that up too, and Mitch, you've been handling that as well. What challenges are involved with that as opposed to the mouse keyboard interface you've been talking about?
It was designed for the beginning to work with both.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, and you know, even even with the new UI, it's you basically the big thing that you have to think about as an interface designer is mouse over and how you're going to replace that.
Yes.
And then secondarily making sure that all your touch targets are large enough, which we've already done the legwork on with our previous release. So that's convenient. And then the last thing is just making sure that it runs.
Yeah, in memory.
There's a lot of stuff in the game, so optimizing enough that it all fits inside that tiny tablet.
Let's see. Hi, Optic. What's up, man?
And I agree. Dante's backstory is definitely one of the most nuanced. he brings an air of quiet dignity.
See, in the game of the year, Dante, Side Quest. Oh my god. Yeah.
I'm haunted by his backstory and quiet nobility. Haunted is definitely the term. Let's see. And I see now, interesting. When I highlight over this, I just pulled out this lecture core to see, and now it has this thing that shows me not only the percentages, but also says heavy cover intervening. So that actually is telling me specifically what's addressing it. That's cool.
Yep. And you'll see it also say things like flanked.
Right, yeah, I'd actually hit one of them that was a flanking shot, supposedly.
Yeah.
This is a terrible tactical situation. Oh, that's interesting, a move and attack. So that's a new component as well. You can run somewhere and then fire or attack from where it is you just moved, basically.
Popped it out more. It actually used to exist, but the UI didn't do a good job of communicating it. And so
I didn't realize.
Accidentally. Yeah.
So there's a rule around here. Subtlety has no place in video games.
Right. So drawing a nice yellow line to explain exactly where you're going to go if you're going to move an attack is a good thing.
Yeah.
Let's see. Sping asks, was the again, just so everybody knows, first of all, again, I am interviewing the guys from Harebrained Schemes, Mitch Gittleman, Mike McCain, Andrew McIntosh. As always, these guys are doing a great job. And Sping, I'll ask that question so you guys know. If you have a question for these guys, please just capitalize the question word so I can actually see it in chat. Sping asks, was the save anywhere function a big demand for players, or was that play to be had regardless? I think it's both, right? Because I know that I was demanding it. I was like, please God, make a save anywhere function. Was that also something you planned at the beginning, or did you respond to feedback mostly for that one?
Michael, take that.
Sure. So save game systems are very complicated systems, and it was certainly something we talked about during the original development.
Oh, yeah.
We made the decision, which I still stand by, that due to the complexity of everything else that we were constructing for the first time, that it didn't fit in the original release.
Yeah, absolutely.
And then, we got a lot of feedback about it, and it was valid feedback, and we responded as soon as we could.
Yeah.
Excellent. Let's see. I see, and the 64% from Glory continues to be as bad as always. Darn it, Glory.
Spin-off. Andrew's already on the show, James. We'll bring it to Broadway.
Yeah, absolutely.
Oh my god. I don't know if you knew this. We're working with Joss Whedon on the musical version of Dragonfall.
Yeah, absolutely.
That's
I sing
awesome.
Every bit as well as Dietrich does, and mm-hmm. I think I'm the right man to write the songs for this production.
Nice.
Yeah, I agree. That's going to be hot.
Nice. It's starring, George Clooney will be somewhere in there as well. And
oh, Clooney can't sing, but Felicia Day can sing.
Felicia Day. Oh, he sang a little bit of Where Brother Art, though. But that's true. Felicia Day would actually make more sense.
That was not him.
I know. I was joking. Yes. No, I know. Yeah, I know. It's Dan Jaminski, I know, from Union Station. Who's awesome, by the way. Messiah asked, question, can we get a Dietrich the Musical spinoff? Yes. Well, that's...
No, I want to pull out of them right now and say yes, there will be a Dietrich Musical spinoff.
Oh, that's funny. Yeah, Fishkill was actually going along with these. Like, oh, GTFO, for real? No, not for real, Fish. Not for real. If
no,
only,
not
though.
For...
I'm going to get emails from Jordan all night.
Yep.
About our proposed musical. Spell.
What did you do? What did you do?
He's like, wait, I got an idea for a musical.
Oh my
whole
god.
New direction.
Yeah,
there's a whole Google Doc on the Chevron musical.
I'm going to announce it right now. Dietrich on Ice. That's our next piece.
Dietrich on Ice.
I can either confirm nor deny Dietrich on ice, but I'm excited about it.
There you go, Glory. You can be taught. Let's see. Question. Does my grade, and that is not a question. Does Mike Tyson stick a cameo spot in the musical? That question does not, yes. Will not be asked. And sure, it's completely untrue. Although Mike Tyson should be a playable character. That's actually a good question. Did you have, was there anyone that you were thinking of to sort of Tuckerize into this, either as part of the original Kickstarter that was done, or was there ever a thought of trying to get, you know, someone, either a famous celebrity or someone like that, you know, Vin Diesel or something, and get him a character in the actual game, or was there never any sort of movement towards that? I'm curious if you even got the question about that.
That would be Kratz.
Yes. But effective, maybe.
But a major character in the game is definitely based on a famous actor.
Sure, ah, yeah. Okay.
In the original Shadowrun Returns, the bouncer in the Seamstress's Union was based on Chris Cluey.
Oh, famous NFL kicker.
The punter, yeah. No kidding.
Who was also one of our backers.
Welcome to Nerdville. Yeah.
Actually, Chris Cluey was one of your backers? Oh, that's amazing. That guy's incredible. Oh, yeah. That guy's been on Wait, Don't Tell Me, and he's amazing.
Yeah. Oh, Cluey's awesome, and he was a great backer. He was a really good sport. But yeah, actually, didn't we name his character Cluey?
We did, yeah.
We did, yeah.
Well, you did. I wasn't here yet. But yeah.
Yeah, it's like, why don't we just call this guy Cluey?
That's funny.
But yeah, and there's a major character in Shadowrun Returns that's based on a major still living actor.
There's a few, yeah.
Yeah, at least one.
Interesting. Okay, let me get...
Oh, and Mitch is in Dragonfall, like, twice. So.
Twice in Dragonfall, because this phase could launch 1,000 ships.
I'm guessing Dietrich is based on a real actor, Shane says.
There was a couple references that we drew upon for his concept art, but I'm blanking on their names, unfortunately.
Have some more cough medicine, Mike.
That's your department.
Robin, you're driving.
Store process. 0% complete. It's going to take a while. As always, even in the future, when you're being attacked by waves and waves of enemies, nothing ever downloads at the right speed. That's just to be noted. Comment, I love the Shadowrun BBS in the game. That was a cool touch. I like that as well. I thought that was a neat little addition to the game also.
That's one of the things about the period of Shadowrun history that we really focus on is there's no such thing as Wi-Fi. You know, Wi-Fi is sci-fi. It's all... it is a 1992 vision of the future.
So, Steve Jobs never existed.
Right, exactly. So, I mean, it's like, the dark future of 2054, but the computing technology is roughly equivalent to 2006 or so.
Yeah. But we don't think of it as kitsch.
No, not at all. I mean, it's very respectful. It is... We're trying to be very respectful to our vision of what the future would look like in 1992.
Mm-hmm. So you went back to go forward or something, or forward to go back.
You've got to go back.
Yeah, just go back to. Let's think of the time period we're talking about here, right? Like the ultimate vision of the future at the time was the film The Lawnmower Man.
Blade Runner was out.
It was, but I mean, again, it's like
the lawnmower.
Our opinion of what would happen with computing technology was so out of sync with what happened as compared to all other forms of technology.
Sure.
The idea that computing would undergo the quantum leaps that it did wasn't really there.
No, of course not. But that also means if we make more Shadowrun content, we have to put Pierce Brosnan in.
Oh, absolutely, and Jeff Fahey.
No. That's where I draw the line.
Cyborg
Holy
Man
crap. No, not Jeff Bezos.
Brosnan plays Jake.
I like it. Look at this. This is how we collaborate.
Absolutely.
This is the synergy.
We get drunk and talk about the Lawnmower Man.
Yeah,
that's
yeah.
We...
No, I see it. I see it all.
Never, ever want to talk about Lawnmower Man again. Holy crap.
Let's see. Fenrir asks, what is the favorite class, weapon type, and special skill of each of the devs on stream.
Oh, sweet Jesus.
Dad?
That's a good question. I mean, I'm a little bit torn. You know, with the new crew advancement system that we put in, we give you the option at each level of advancement for each of the NPCs. Yeah, it is nice shilling, but it's